presentation. So I want to, I'm quite grateful to the previous speaker for introducing linear cryptanalysis and D-structure. So Matsui linear cryptanalysis is based on distribution of XOR of cipher plaintext bits X1 XS and ciphertext bits Y1 YT in algorithm 1. In algorithm 2, bits X are input to the second round of the encryption, and Y inputs to the last round of the encryption. So we managed to find a method to compute the joint distribution of X and Y that is a vectorial random variable. And this was the starting point in our work. Both distributions, Matsui's distribution and our distribution, are approximations. And they depend on the small sets of cipher key bits or linear combination of the cipher key bits. And then briefly, algorithm to cryptanalysis is applied. This is outline of the rest of the talk. So first, I remind about Matsui algorithm 2 and about logarithmic likelihood ratio statistic. Then I introduce a new statistic, which is most suitable for multidimensional cryptanalysis. And then show that deciding on values of the key bits relevant to the statistic may be represented as an instance of optimization problem. And I will introduce a search algorithm to solve this problem, and then give some details on implementation of the attack against the 16-round DS, and then show how we managed to compute multidimensional distribution in faithful ciphers. And then I will go to conclusions. Okay, first is about Matsui algorithm 2 and the conventional statistic. In algorithm 2 by Matsui, encryption is split into three parts. It's the first round of the encryption, internal rounds, and the last one. And our vector is X and Y. And its distribution depends somehow on some key bits, which are relevant to the internal rounds. But observation is not available because observation depends not only on the plaintext, but also in some key bits from the first round. And the same for observation Y. So one can say that distribution on X and Y and observation depend on all these key bits shown here. Now, logarithmic likelihood ratio statistic is used to distinguish two distribution with densities, distribution P and Q, by observing independent observations. This is the most powerful test according to Neyman-Pearson lemma. And the test says that we accept P if the value of this function, which is sum of logarithms of values, ratio of values P under observation in Q, is larger than some threshold. And left-hand side function is called logarithmic likelihood ratio statistic. It's already shown that, I'm sorry, it's too fast. As already mentioned, distribution of X and Y depends on some key bits, and the observation of X and Y depends on some other key bits. So LRR statistic should depend on all these key bits. And this statistic may be used to distinguish correct value of relevant key bits against incorrect value. However, to do that, we need so many computations of values of this statistic. So it's feasible when the size of the set is relatively small. But when vector X and Y is large, its distribution observation depends on so many key bits, and this is not efficient. So instead, in this work, we suggest using a new statistic, and with the new statistic, computation is much faster. In our experimenting with DS, it's 1,000 times faster than with conventional LRR statistic. And this new statistic reflects the structure of the round function. It depends on how its boxes, how round implement using its boxes. And of course, our new statistic is not optimal because LLR statistic is optimal according to name and Pearson lemma. But this statistic is not optimal. But as we can compute, we solve statistical problem much faster, trade-off is positive. So now I explain how this new statistic was constructed. We have our vector x and y, and we know its distribution. And we take some subvectors of this vector. Let we take m subvectors. Or I call this subvectors projections. It may be any functions in these bits. And those projections are taking such that distribution observation for each of them depend on a low number of key bits. So this is qubits which are relevant to distribution of this, and these are qubits which are relevant to observation of this. Now we construct LLR statistic for each of these subvectors, and then consider vector of these LLR statistics. As we know distribution of this vector, it's easy to compute distribution of this vector, and easy to compute distribution of this vector. And asymptotically, this vector is distributed as an invariant normal random variable. If a key is correct, so we have one distribution. If key is incorrect, so distribution is close to something opposite. And these are parameters of the distribution, some mean vector mu, a covariance matrix C, and the number of plaintext N. Now the problem is to distinguish these two normal distributions. We can use again LLR statistic to do that. Usually when you want to distinguish two multivariate normal distributions, LLR statistic is quadratic. But in this case, because covariance matrix is the same, statistic degenerates to linear. So that this statistic to distinguish these two is the sum of the statistics for each of the projections. So that one can say that this statistic is separable. So that it statistic represented the sum of statistics with for smaller parameters. Such statistics were called separable, and the theory of such statistics was developed by Russian mathematicians Ivchenko and Medvedev quite long ago. But we use here only notion of the statistic and not any theory about them. Now, because we know distributions of everything, we can compute distribution of our main statistic. It's one-variate normal distribution with parameters U its expectation and U its variance for some explicit positive U if key is correct. If it's not correct, it's something opposite. Okay. So now what we need in cryptanalysis? In cryptanalysis, we need to solve this inequality. So that we need to find the values of the key such that this inequality is satisfied. And then we accept this as a correct one. But we want to do that without brute forcing these qubits. And that can be done because our statistic is a sum of some functions in a low number of parameters, of variables. And in our experiment with DES, the size of this set is 54 bits, and the size of this set for every I is around 20. And that can be represented as solving an optimization problem, and method to solve this optimization problem is a tree search. Now I discuss optimization problem and introduce search algorithm. So optimization problem is to find, say in this small example, to find the binary x1, x2, x3 such that this function is larger than 1.2. 0.3. And functions S1, S2, S3 are real valued functions defined on vectors of length 2. This is the definition of S1, definition of S2, S3. You can check that 1, 1, 1 is the only solution to this problem, because if 1, 1, 1, we can see that 1, 1, 1 chooses this column, this column, and this column, and sum of all three values is 1.4, is it bigger than 1.3. So solution is working over search tree. We start at the root, then we assign to x1 value 0 and look at this inequality and try to understand if it's feasible or not. If it's not feasible, we cut this branch in x1 0, it's not feasible, and we try x1 and check if it's feasible. It's feasible, then we continue. So one to check 6 linear inequalities in this example, and brute force takes 8 inequalities. So this is faster. In the same way we solve what we need, actually, this inequality. Now, output of this research is key candidates for the final brute force. And test distribution of the main statistic is known. We can compute theoretically success probability of this attack and the number of wrong solutions that is a key candidate to brute force. That is done theoretically. Now I say a few words about implementation details for DES. So DES input to DES is a 64-bit block. It's split into two parts. It's a 32-bit block, 32-bit blocks. This is plain text. It's a cipher text after 16 rounds. It's a cipher key. Matsui best linear approximation for 14 rounds is given here. It's a sum of 8 bits. Those bits are part of the cipher text. This bit is input to the last round. These three bits, So these three bits are input to the second round. We take all these bits, it's a linear combination, that is XOR of all these 8 bits, but we take all these 8 bits as a vector and add more bits, and we get a vector, and we get vector of length 14, and by symmetry, and we, so it's very close to these two buttons. So we can compute distribution of this vector. It's a vector of length 14. And by DES symmetry, we can use another vector also of length 14. And distributions are are the same after permuting the bits. As these two vectors incorporate different internal bits of the encryption, we consider them independent. And computing their distribution with our formulas took a few seconds. Now, for each of them, for each of these two vectors, we take 14 projections, overall 28 projections represented here. And each for each projection, LLR statistic depends on at most 21 qubits. Overall, the number of qubits involved here is 54. Now we construct two separable statistics and apply search algorithm. And search algorithm reconstructs 54-bit key candidates for the final brute force. So how it looks for one projection is shown here. So we take projection H1, this vector of length 10, and all relevant qubits, those qubits, I remind, qubits which affect distribution of this vector, and those qubits affect observation of this vector. The set incorporates 20 unknowns, written here. This unknowns from the DES master key. And we can compute to power 20 values of the statistic S1. And similar is done for all other 27 projections. So now we want to construct a tree and work over this tree. In this case, we need to order relevant key bits to run this tree search. And the order is very easy. We take the first variable, which appears in the maximal number of these subsets. So the second most common X19 and so on. And the order actually affects the complexity of the tree. Now we run experiment. We fix the desirable success rate. It's, for example, 83%. It's close to Matsui, but a little bit different due to some bad planning. Then we solve the equation in N. N is the number of plain text. And another parameter is here is a threshold. We find threshold for our statistics such that the number of plain text equals the number of keys to brute force in the final stage of the analysis. And we got that number of plain text to 2^41.8. And then we run a search tree algorithm. This is complexity in log scale. This is number of nodes at each level of the tree. So, and we got finally the number of key candidates in relevant key bits is given by this number. And this is number of keys to brute force is the same as here. As this was done experimentally, that is, this somehow gives idea that our method is correct. But, however, the number of nodes in the tree is 2^45.5. It's larger than complexity of brute force. But constructing one node is a very simple operation. It's just checking two linear inequalities with low precision real numbers. So in bit operations, constructing so many nodes in the tree is lower than brute forcing with DS so many keys. As it improves Matsui result on DS, which according to the previous talk was 2^43, with success rate was 85%. But remark that in contrast with Matsui result, this success rate was computed experimentally for 8 rounds and then extrapolated to 16 rounds. But this success rate is computed purely theoretically. Now I want to say a few words, if I have time, about how to compute multidimensional distributions in faceted ciphers. So assume that we have R round DS. This is a plain text, this is cipher text, this is cipher key. Assume that X is random, so every bit in encryption algorithm is a random variable. And let E be any event inside the encryption. And we want to compute its probability. And I want to formalize this problem to put into mathematical form. So the construction is the following, that x0, x1, xr plus 1, this is internal blocks in DES, randomly independent 32-bit blocks. But it doesn't define a cipher. And we take some auxiliary event C, which defines actually the cipher, and that is given by these formulas. And F is a round function of DES. And KI are fixed round keys. Now, probability of the event is actually probability of the event in this scheme under condition of the C. And by conditional probability formula, we can write this ratio. And then probability of this event is very easy to compute, is 2^-this number. So, and we want to find this probability. But as this event depends on all qubits of the cipher, this is actually infeasible to compute. So it's a very complicated function. So we need some approximation to this. And that may be done by relaxing this event C, which defines DS. So we take a large event in the sense that main event C, which defines cipher, implies event C alpha, as it is given by these formulas, where alpha I is a subset of indices for each sublock in DS. And alpha is a concatenation of this, it's a vector of this subset of indices. And probability of this event, it's also very easy to compute, is given by this formula. And now, instead of this, we compute its approximation. Why this is approximation? It's because if we extend, take a larger subset of indices, C alpha tends to C. But we accept anyway that it's approximation. And for this conditional probability, we use the same formula. And then we need to compute the probability of our targeted event together with this event. And that was actually done in Matsui work implicitly. But I did it explicitly here. And that is more feasible because this event depends only on low number of the qubits. Now I should say something about trails. So assume that you want to compute distribution of this vector. These two subvectors are input to encryption function. This is output after R rounds. Those are some indices. We define some event C alpha. Our approximation depends on how we choose this event. Assume that we take some event C alpha, then we construct trail. Trail consists of some input bits for Fi and some output bits of Fi. And we call the trail regular if this condition is satisfied, where Xi gamma input bits relevant to F. I alpha. And this condition is very similar to Matsui's condition. In Matsui condition, if you remember that this beta is XOR of these two. But here we consider not a linear approximation, we consider it's vectorial random variables. In this case, we need a bit different, but the sense is the same. We need some condition on the trail. And for regular trails, which satisfies this condition, we can compute distribution of this vector by using some convolution type formula. This formula is given on this slide. So Z, again, I remind that it's a vector distribution of which we want to compute. We want to compute probability that Z equals some vector A. It means that this part equals this part, this part equals this part, this part equals this part, and this part equals this part under condition C alpha. And this is exact formula. And this is sum of products of probabilities from round subvector distributions. And they are computed from the definition of DES round. And this has some relevant qubits. And this formula is quite complicated to handle because a lot of summons in this formula. But due to the round structure of the cipher, we can split encryption into two parts and compute it by parts. And in this case, it's very easy computation. It's only a few seconds for 14 round DS to compute distribution of a very large vector, actually. Okay, almost done with conclusions. So in this work, we suggest method of computing joint distributions of encryption internal bits, X and Y, for faceted cipher. For SPN, it's about the same logic may be applied. And we realize that conventional logarithmic likelihood ratio statistic is inefficient. So we suggested new statistic which reflects round structure of the round function. we computed its distribution and able to predict success probability and the size of the final brute force, and also efficient search algorithm to find key candidates which fall into critical region is suggested. So we got an improvement of mature result in DES, at least in bit operations, and we're able to predict correctly success probability. For 8 rounds, we're able to check if our success probability is real success probability, and the number of key, final key candidates for 16 round DS. And our search algorithm to solve optimization problem is 1,000 times faster than brute forcing all relevant key bits. This is the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Question for Igor. I have one. Can you go back to the number of nodes?
Which one?
Yep, here. Mm-hmm. So I can see the number of nodes is much higher than the complexity for brute force. And so when you build a tree, do you need to actually sort the nodes? Like, do you need a binary search tree? Or
this is a binary search tree. We construct nodes, but constructing nodes is a very simple operation. It's only a few XORs.
Yeah, but for each insertion, there will be some more operation according to the depth of the tree, right?
No, for each, this is the number of nodes. Oh, I'm sorry. This is the number of nodes. So complexity of the tree is the number of nodes, of course. It's proportional to the number of nodes. But complexity to construct one node is a few XORs.
Yeah, I mean, constructing the entire tree, is it complexity n times log n?
Complexity of the tree is a number of nodes. We have some node, and we get some new node. And we should check two linear inequalities at this node. If they are satisfied, we continue constructing node. If not satisfied, we cut this branch. So that complexity of this node, that node, to checking two linear inequalities with real numbers.
Okay.
Okay.
More question for Igor? If not, let's thank Igor again.
Okay, thank you.